فؤادك الأيام فتى. The second virtue is what? This field, the second benefit or virtue that's in it, the second virtue that you get is what? Is that usul al-fiqh, its virtue is that it's lahu min al-fadli ma li ghayatihi al-fiqhiyya min fadli wa qadr. The virtue, the excessive virtue that fiqh has, when a person perfects his salah, when a person perfects his tahara, when a person does his hajj correctly, when the person does his zakat and he pays it on the right time and he stays away from the prevention, the virtue that has, usul al-fiqh has it. Because it's the ability to understand those. Na'am. Very good. Who's the first person who placed this field? Who put it down? The first person who placed this field, pay attention, as a subject called usul al-fiqh. Who placed it as a subject that is studied separately? Imam al-Shafi'i. Why did I say a subject that is studied separately? All of that. Why did I say it? Because the field existed before him. And Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah. It existed before him. But it existed in what way? It existed as a natural manner. As the poet, he said, لَسْتُ بِنَحْوِيٍ يَلُوكُ لِسَانَهُ وَلَكِنِّي سَلِيقِيٍ أَقُولُ فَأُعْرِفْ. I am not a grammarian. He's an Arab Bedouin man. He said, I'm not a grammarian. If you're asking me مُبْتَدَعَ خَبَرٌ and فَاعِلًا مَفْعُولٌ بِهِ and فِعْلٌ لَازِمٌ فِعْلٌ مُتَعَدِّيًا جُمْلَ إِسْمِيَةٌ جُمْلَ فِعْلِيَةٌ شِبْهُ جُمْلَ, I don't know that. But I'm an Arab who Arabic is, I'm naturally an Arab. When I speak grammatically correct. But I don't need it. I don't know these terms that you guys use to understand Arabic language. So that's how it used to be before these subjects. This is how it used to be. The scholars, they knew it before naturally. They didn't need these fields to be put in place. So Shafi'i, he only writ what was natural and he made it a subject. So we're talking about who made it a subject. They never said, عَامٌ إِلَّا مَا أَخَصَّهُ الدَّلِيلِ الْأَمْرُ تَقْتَضِي الْوُجُوبِ مَا لَمْ يَأْتِي قَرِينَ تُصَرِّفْ عَنِ الْوُجُوبِ إِلَى النَّدْرِ. They weren't saying these qawa'id. That's not, they weren't doing that. They weren't saying qawa'id al-usuliyya, no qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. Rather, what they were doing was what? The matter was saliqi. The Prophet commanded, it shows obligation, we'll take it. So the first person who wrote it, أول من صنف في الكتب محمد بن الشافع المطلب وغيره كان له سليقا مثل الذي للعرب من خليقا. As the author of Maraq al-Su'ud said, everyone before that, it was saliqi, like the Arabs, it was the Arabic language, saliqi for them. So the first one who wrote it was Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, who died the year 204. He died the year 204. And he was born what year? 150. Imam al-Shafi'i only lived for 54 years. This Imam, who a whole madhab follows, he became a whole madhab, and thousands of people follow, he was what? He wrote this field and rahimahullah ta'ala. But he wrote it with the command of who? He wrote it with the command of his teacher, AbdulRahman ibn Mahdi. AbdulRahman ibn Mahdi told him to write it. He wrote a book which he called it Al-Risala. He called the book what? Al-Risala. And there's another book he wrote, he called it Juma'ul Ilm. It's called Jima'ul Ilm, or you can call it Juma'ul Ilm, which is also a book which is Usul al-Fiqh again. And if you look at his kit al-um, his which is a narration from him, who narrated it from him? Rabi' ibn Sulayman al-Muradi, his student. Shafi'i student, Rabi' ibn Sulayman al-Muradi, he narrated the from Imam Shafi'i. And sometimes he asked the question Imam Shafi'i and Imam Shafi'i replies back. Are you with me? The Kitab al-Risala and Jumma'u al-Ilm, both of them are now, walillahi alhamdu wal-minnah, they are published inside his al-Umm, al-Imam Shafi'i's Umm. But Ahmed Shakir, Ahmed Muhammad Shakir, the great muhaddith of Egypt, he's the one who worked on the book al-Risala. He worked on it. You see, he worked on it. And inshallah ta'ala, if Allah gives us the time, it will be very good for us to study this book, al-Risala and Jumma'ul Ilm. Rather, I promise inshallah ta'ala, one of the books after that, Jumma'ul Ilm will take it inshallah ta'ala. That book Jumma'ul Ilm by Imam Shafi'i will take it inshallah ta'ala after these books when we study them inshallah ta'ala. But what do you realize, what did he do at that time, Imam Shafi'i? Imam Shafi'i, he brought two madhabs that were present at that time. Two what? Madhabs. There was the madhab of who? Ahlul Ra'yi. And there was the scholars of Hadith, Ahlul Hadith. You see, Imam Shafi'i with the field of usul al-fiqh, he brought Ahlul Ra'yi, their view, the issue of Qiyas, with its conditions attached to it, he brought it in his book. And Ahlul Hadith, who were what? Ahlul Haqq, always. He brought their matters together. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. And because of that, they refer to Imam Shafi'i as what? Nasir al-Sunnah. Rahimahullah, they called him what? Nasir al-Sunnah. His book, as Imam Shatibi said in his Kitab al-I'tisam, this is what he said about this field. He said, مَقَاسِدُ الشَّرِيعَةِ فَحَصَّلُوهَا وَأَسَّسُوا قَوَاعِدَهَا وَأَصَّلُوهَا. Talking about Imam Shafi'i. He said the objectives of the Sharia. He made a fundamental, Shafi'i made a what? He done the asas, the foundation, and the qawa'id that are in it. He did it. وَجَالَتْ أَفْكَارُهُمْ فِي آيَاتِهَا وَأَعْمَلُوا الْجِدَّ فِي تَحْقِيقِ مَبَادِئِهَا وغاياتها وعنوا بعد ذلك باطراح الآمال وشفعوا العلم بالإصلاح الأعمال وسابقوا إلى الخيرات وسبقوا وسارعوا إلى الصالحات فما لحقوا إلى أن طالع في آفاق بصائر الشمس الفرقان وأشرف في قلوبه نور الإيقان فظهرت ينابيع الحكم منها على اللسان فهم أهل الإسلام والإيمان والإحسان وكيف لا وقد كانوا أول من قرع ذلك الباب فصاروا خاصة الخاصة ولباب اللباب ونجوما يهتدي بأنوارهم أولو الألباب رضي الله عنهم وعن الذين خلفوهم قدوة للمقتدين وأسوة للمهتدين والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Praising the scholars who came and who put the objective of the Sharia in place, who wrote قواعد and أصول, رحمه الله. In his book Al-I'tisam, first page 7. First volume, sorry, first volume and the 7th page. What's this field called? The seventh point. What's this field called? علم أصول الفقه is what it's called. Number 8. استمداد, where is it rooted from? It is rooted from التتبع والاستقراء التام. It is they followed up the kitab and the sunnah. They followed up the kitab and the sunnah. And they also followed up what? Atharu salaf al-ummah. The salaf al-salih, the pious predecessors, their statements. Wa lughat al-arab, and the Arabic language. Wa dalalat al-aql, and also the logic, the evidences of the logic. As-sariha, that's straight. Al-muwafiqu, that goes agreement with what? Lil-naql al-sahih, that goes. Because qiyas is going to go with the text. So that's it, number 8. Number 9, حُكْمُهُ, what is the ruling for أصول الفقه? It is فَرْضُ عَيْنٍ. أصول الفقه is فَرْضُ عَيْنٍ. On who لكن? عَلَى كُلِّ مَنْ يَتَصَدَّرَ لِلْفُتْيَا. Anyone who goes forward to give fatwa. وَالِجْتِهَاد, anyone who wants to strive by giving rulings. He has to learn it. It's فَرْضُ عَيْنٍ on him. But it's فَرْضُ كِفَايَةٍ on what? On the rest of the ummah. عَلَى مَجْمُوعِ الْأُمَّةِ إِذَا قَامَ بِهِ بَعْضٍ على سبيل الكفاية وقضى الحاجة سقط عن الباقين والله أعلم. The rest don't have to come with it. As If you're not, you're just a normal person, those who are learning it can suffice you for it. As long as there are people who are standing for it, the responsibility is taken off your shoulder. But if you're going out and you're giving talks and reminders and you're doing university lectures and you're going to and you're reminding and you're answering questions that people put questions forward to you and then you're answering them, usul al-fiqh is obligatory for you to learn. Fardu ayn. Fardu ayn. Masailu. The masail. Huh? What the masail? What is a masail? Masail is, it falls under fusul. So when we get a book, it's categorized into this. It is kitab, bab, fasl, and then masail. Masail is the last one. So it's a book. We have, then we have bab, 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 bab. And then we have what? Fasl, 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 within the bab. And then within the fasl, we have what? Masail. What are the masail that usul al-fiqh deals with? Again, as I said to you, it guides the mujtahid, the person who's doing ijtihad, in his ijtihad to extract rulings correctly. Those are the 10 points that we need to know about usul al-fiqh. That was the mabadi' al-ashara. The 10 points that everybody has to know about a field which they want to study. I'm going to, inshallah ta'ala, going to explain to you a benefit, which is the methodology of how to study usul al-fiqh. The methodology of how to seek usul al-fiqh. What we have to really know, brothers and sisters, is anything a person is learning, and that a person wants to acquire a good understanding from, what is needed from him is that the abridged and the summarized books of that field, try to memorize the summarized. So these, the usul al-fiqh has books which we book big books. Like Al-Muwafaqat by Imam al-Shatibi, Al-I'tisam, Al-Burhan, Irshad al-Fuhul, Al-Muswadda li-Ali Taymiyyah. These are big books. These are what? Big books of usul al-fiqh. You may not understand them. So a student of knowledge, the methodology he needs to take in order to learn usul al-fiqh is that he memorizes the mukhtasarat, the summarized, abridged books of each field. You want to learn Nahu? Memorize the small, summarized, abridged books of Nahu. If the person is unable to memorize it word for word, فَإِن تَعَذَّرَ أَوْ تَعَسَّرَ عَلَيْهِ حِفْظَ لَفْظًا حِفْظُهُ لَفْظًا, word for word he can't memorize, it's too hard for him. فَلْيُكَرِّرْهُ, repeat it so many times. And read it so many times. Hatta, until it what? Hatta tarsaqu ma'anihi fi qalbik, that the meaning it soaks into your heart. Repeat it so many times that the meaning soaks into your heart. And so key words that are needed, you know them. Because wallahi, if a person memorizes the usul of each field, usul al-fiqh, mustalah al-hadith, al-luwat al-arabiyyah, he studies and he memorizes books on it. And then after that, he has what? Understanding and comprehension of what he's memorized. Then what? The scholars, they say, man dayya al-usula, hurima al-usula. Anyone who forsakes the abridged books or the objective knowledge, the instrumental knowledges, anyone who forsakes that and doesn't give it importance, he will be prohibited from reaching his goal. You ain't gonna reach far with usul fiqh. You see? You ain't gonna get far in learning the Quran and understanding it if you haven't studied Arabic language, if you haven't studied usul tafsir, and etc. ولذلك, the scholars also used to say, من حفظ المتون حاز الفنون. Anyone who memorizes these little books you put in the pockets? Huh? He will reach far into the subjects. But, وَلِذَلِكَ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ, sometimes we used to see ulama and strong students of knowledge who will go to a library who won't even buy much books. They'll just buy little books. Little books. And put it into their pockets and they'll go. Why? Because they knew that the importance of it is that they memorize this stuff. So brothers and sisters, strive to memorizing these small little books and to learning that. وَمَنْ سَلَكَ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ غَيْرَ هَذِهِ الطَّرِيقَةِ النَّافِعَةِ فَاتَتْ عَلِهِ الْأَوْقَاتِ A lot of time is going to be wasted from you. I can assure you on that. وَلَمْ يُدْرِكْ إِلَّا الْعَنَاءِ And you're not going to go through except tiredness. You're going to be so tired. You're going to feel your shoes is finishing. You're always on the road. You're coming to this place. You're learning. And you're not reaching nowhere. You see? As it's known by what? بِالْمُشَاهَدَةِ وَالْتَجْرُبَةِ Everyone knows. But if you memorize, you come to see that you understand it very well. You will you'll know it very well. Also, brothers, a person has to solidify his foundations. A student of knowledge, فَلَا بُدَّ It is necessary, مِنَ التَّأْصِيرِ وَالتَّأْسِيسِ The first years of your seeking your knowledge, work hard on just studying the fundamental stuff. Solidify yourself, make yourself strong. In what? لِكُلِّ فَنٍ تَطْلُبُهُ All the fields which you're studying. You want to study fiqh? Say, wait, I don't, before I go to fiqh. Usul fiqh. Solidify me on it. Arabic language, solidify me on it. And the student gives time to that. He gives time to that. By taking that a book in that field, like this book that we're studying, Risalatul Latifah, and he memorizes it. So when he memorizes it, it's a summary, so he takes a mukhtasar and he memorizes it. Okay? And who and then after he's studied and he's memorized it, he reads it on what? Ala shaykhin mutqinin. A person who this book is so easy for him. ولذلك الإمام الشاطبي رحمه الله when he spoke about the ways to seek knowledge, he said, he spoke about two means, two ways. One is called مشافحة. مشافحة means what? وهو أن يجلس الطالب. It is that the student sits بين يدي معلمه. بين يدي معلمه. A student of knowledge sits in front of a teacher. And the teacher reads to you, and he educates you. He said, Imam Shatibi, وَهُوَ أَنْفَعُ طُرُقُ الْعِلْمِ It's the best way to learn. A teacher's there, he's reading it for you, he's going it through with you, he's correcting your speech, he's correcting the understanding that you've taken from this. That's the best way. The second one is what? الْمُطَالَعَ Reading. Going to what? Going to the books. الْمُجَلَّدَاتِ فِي بُطُونِ الْكُتُبِ وَالْمُجَلَّدَاتِ You go to the books and you study and you read and you learn and you educate yourself like that. That is only beneficial when you have what? The usul strong, solidified. Your what? Your ta'seen and the ta'sis is strong. Mm-hmm. Also, brothers, what I want you to remember, inshallah ta'ala, is this point. These points I'm going to tell you are very important, inshallah ta'ala. In front of you is everyone. These matters, لا بد من مراعاتها, that you observe these matters that you want to learn. Are you wanting to learn? Observe these things. In every كل فن تطلبه, in every field that you're trying to learn from. Number one, حفظ مختصر فيه. Try to memorize one at least one book in that field. One مختصر, try to memorize it. Second thing is ضبط على شيخ متقن. Try to, inshallah ta'ala, to read it on a person who knows that field very well. Very well. He knows it very well. Ask the teacher, read it to me. Have I understood it very well? ولذلك الإمام بكر أبو زيد in his book, حلية طالب العلم here, which I have, he says, احرص على قراءة التصحيح والضبط على شيخ متقن لتأمن من التحريف والتصحيف والغلط والوهم. He said this in his 65th page. He says, read on a teacher who is good, who knows this field. So why? So you can be safe from incorrect pronunciation and reading. So you can be safe from mistakes and shortcomings and misunderstanding that you might have regarding a matter. It's a methodology. The third one is عدم الاشتغال بالمطولات وتفاريق المصنفات قبل الضبط والإتقان لأصله. Which is تحرير مسائله. Don't busy yourself with big volumes of books. and books which have spoken about these matters too much. Don't busy yourself with those mutawwalat and tafariq al-masail where it's in. Don't go to those books. Without you what? قَبْلَ طَبْطِ الْوَالْإِتْقَانِ لِأَصْلِهِ If you haven't solidified yourself upon a مُخْتَصَر, a summarized and abridged book. Number four, لَا تَنْتَقِلْ مِنْ مُخْتَصَرٍ إِلَىٰ آخَرَ بِلَا مُوجِبٍ فَهَذَا مِنَ بَابِ الضَّجْرِ سَأَمَ and malal come from this. Don't jump from one book to another book when you haven't finished reading this book or studying this book. Make sure you finish that book first. Student of knowledge, he shouldn't jump from one مختصر to another مختصر to another مختصر to another مختصر. Finish this one first. Unless there is a necessity for it. Or else what's going to happen? You're going to be tired, you're going to be lazy, and you're going to give up on it. Number five, اقتناص الفوائد والضوابط العلمية. The student of knowledge, brothers, he has to have a pen and paper. And he, whilst the teacher sometimes is going to give you benefits that he got from the midst of volumes, is going to give you a benefit. That may take you years of your life to find this kind of benefit. You straight away, you write that benefit down. And you learn this poetry, inshallah ta'ala, brothers. Al-ilmu saydun wal-kitabatu qayduhu. Qayyid suyudaka bil-hibali al-wathiqi. Famin al-hamaqati an-tasida ghazalatan wa tatruka bayna al-khalaiqi taliqa. Knowledge is like hunting a deer. It's like hunting a deer. That's how knowledge is. So, how is it? Writing is the qaid, which is the rope you use when you grab the animal and you keep it, tie it to the tree to make sure that after you've got it. So you've got the deer or the gazelle, you got it and you tied it to the camel. Once you've tied it to the camel, this is your qaid to hold it. Knowledge, the way to hold it after you it came to you, after you grabbed it, is with your pen. The poet then said, وَمِنَ الْحَمَاقَةِ أَنْتَصِيدَ غَزَالَةً It is so dim-witted that you catch a deer and then instead of tying it, you just let it go. Like knowledge comes to you and you just let it go. Just go by quickly. And you don't even write it down and you don't keep it with you. Rather, a student of knowledge should do this. When you write these benefits, you should have a book separate or a place separate where you organize these issues and you put it under the chapter which is befitting. So the teacher might give a fa'idah here. So what you do is when you hear this fa'idah or this quote or this mas'ala ilmiya or this taqsimat, what you do is you put it in a heading, in a place of your book, under a heading, and it grows over time. This mas'ala, I think most befitting place is this chapter for me, and this chapter for me, and this chapter for me. And every now and then you show your teacher, or the person you're studying with, you show them the kind of improvements and how you're writing it and if you've understood it correctly. You read on him. The sixth thing that the student of knowledge needs to do, which is what? جَمْعُ النَّفْسِ لِلطَّلَبِ وَالتَّرَقِّي فِيهِ وَالِهْتِمَامِ وَالتَّحَرُّقِ لِتَحْصِيلِ وَالْبُلُوغِ إِلَى مَا فَوْقَهُ حَتَّى يَفِيضَ الْمُطَوَّلَاتِ بِسَبَالَةٍ مُوثِقَةٍ That you bring yourself, your nafs, your aspiration, to what? To want to grow. That's your objectives. Your objective is what? You want to nurture yourself, to grow, to reach a high position. This is all a stepping stone for you. For you, it's, I'm studying this book and I know I'm going to move on. ولذلك ابن الجوزي رحمه الله, what did he say? He said, Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah in his book Sayyidul Khatir, he said, وَمَنْ تَكُنُ الْعِلْيَا هِمَّةَ نَفْسِهِ فَكُلُّ الَّذِي يَلْقَى فِيهِ مُحَبَّبُ Anybody who has high aspirations, every form of hardship, stress, headache that he goes through, it will be all easy for him. Why? Why will it be easy for him? The reason why it will be easy for him is because he has a high aspiration. ولذلك the scholars, they used to say that sadness is in the body of a person who has high aspiration. His body's gonna die, but he doesn't feel it. He's gonna harm his body because he has high aspiration. His mind is set somewhere. That all of the things that are happening, the walking and the tiredness and the heat and everything, he doesn't really care because of what? ولذلك, you see, even those, anyone who's in love of something always is blinded from the from what he's going through. Like the man who said, أقبل ذا الجدار وذا الجدار وما الجدار شفقنا قلبي ولكن لمن سكن الدياري. He loved a woman who used to live in these houses. So he kissed the wall and he kissed the wall and he kissed the wall. And he said to the people, me kissing these walls isn't because I love the walls. But I love the person who used to live in this walls, behind his house. It was a woman he loved. Layla, he used to love. So he said, meaning, a person will put their body through a lot in order for something they have passion for, and that which they love. You see, so brothers, inshallah ta'ala, take this. Always look into a field. When you study, always try to be ahead of the teacher, let alone not revising what you've been taught. Try to go fast, study. But whatever you learn, bring it back to the teacher and the person you're learning it from. And to research, وَالْفَحْصُ عَنْ هَذَا الشَّأْنِ, this matter that was mentioned, go do your own personal research on it. وَكَثْرَةِ الْمُذَاكَرَةِ, and always excessively revising. And to understand the matter with taqwa and deen, with religion in there. And always coming to the places of the ulama and learning from them. فَدَعَنْكَ الْكِتَابَ لَسْتَ مِنْهَا وَلَوْ سَوَّتَّ وَجْهَكَ بِالْمِدَادِ. قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, اللَّهُ سَرْ, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. So you're always coming to the scholars, you're asking them, you're verifying matters with them. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah, he told us what kind of student of knowledge that you need to be. This is what he told us to be, and this is a very powerful advice by Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah in his book Sir A'lam al-Nubala, the 13th volume, page 380. He said, taqiyyan, be a pious person. Dhakiyyan, a smart person. Nahwiyyan, a grammarian. Lughawiyyan, a person who knows the Arabic language very well. Zakiyyan, a person who's purified. Hayyyan, a person who's alive. Alive. And then he said, Salafiyyan, be a person who's Salafi, who follows the path of the Salaf. As-Sam'ani, rahimullah, in his book, Al-Ansab, what did he say? Salafi, بفتح السين واللام وفي آخرها الفاء, هذا نسبة إلى السلف وانتحال مذهبهم. Salafi means what? Imam Sam'ani said this. Some say Salafi, yesterday it was introduced. And Imam Sam'ani was he died the year 563. 562 or 563, he died. In his book Al-Ansab, what's Al-Ansab? Ascriptions, when people inscript themselves to a land or a place. He wrote in his book, As-Salafi. And he said, Salafi means what? بفتح السين. Because there's a difference between Salafi and Silafi. Abu Tahir al-Silafi. Silafi something else. Silafi means a person whose lip is ripped in the middle. Abu Tahir al-Silafi, he had a lip in his tongue, lip. That's what Silafi means, what? Or it means a person who has his nose and his mouth is open together. Some people who have their mouth and their nose, Silafi. But that's not strong. Silafi is the lower lip of the tongue, of the lip. It's the lower part of the lip. Silafi. He used to have a mark there. But Salafi, which is a Fath Sini, Al-Lam, it is what? Nisbat ila Salafi wa intihali madhabim. It is describing yourself to the Salaf and their methodology. ولذلك الإمام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى, when he was asked about can a person call himself a Salafi, he said, لا عيب, there's no problem, على من انتسب, anyone who has ascribed himself to the Madhab al-Salaf, there's no problem, you can do it, why not? A person can call themselves Salafi. ولذلك الإمام الذهبي himself, in his Sir Alam al-Nubala, the 21st page on the 6th volume, page 21, he said, As-Salafi bi-fathatayni, both of them are fatha. Wa-huwa, and it is, man kana ala madhhab al-Salaf, man kana ala madhhab al-Salaf, anyone who's upon the madhhab of the Salaf. See? So, Salafi is not a bad thing to call yourself. And we see that it was mentioned years ago. It's not something that the Saudi Muhammad Abdul Wahhab or they started. Na'am. Good. So this is what he taqiyyan, dhakiyyan, nahwiyyan, lughawiyyan, zakiyyan, hayyyan, salafiyyan. He told you to be. Very good. Brothers, Ibn Badran al-Dimashqi. Ibn Badran al-Dimashqi, He has a book, very powerful book, which he called it Al-Madkhal ila Madhhab Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He gave us powerful advice to the student of knowledge. A very what? Powerful advice to the student of knowledge. Listen to this advice he gives. He says, "I'lam know, anna nahtadayna bifadlihi ta'ala athna'a talab ila qa'ida." Pay attention to this. He said, we were guided with the permission and the virtue of Allah alone, whilst we were seeking knowledge, to this great principle. This is what we were guided to, this great principle, which is, and you've got to know this principle, that we were, annana kunna na'ti ila al-matn awwalan. We used to come to the matn. And I always advise you, don't get the sharah. Take the matn first. So many people are carrying big shuruh. He doesn't even understand the matn. Understand the matn first, before you move to the sharah. It is what? أننا كنا نأتي إلى المتن أولا. We would used to come to the متن. The متن is the wording of the author first. فنأخذ منه, we would take from it جملة كافية للدرس, enough from the lesson for that portion of the متن. After that, we've taken that from the good portion of it in the class. Then what do we do? ثم نشتغل بحل تلك الجملة من غير نظر إلى شرحها. We will try to solve the sentences without looking at the explanation. So we went to a lesson, we understood it. We will come, each sentence and each point, we'll start to try to solve it and discuss it and not to look into it without looking at any explanation that is put on it. Meaning we'll try to put our own explanation and what we see and ta'aliqat and fawaid on it. وَنُزَاوِلُهَا حَتَّى نَظُنُ أَنَّنَا فَهِمْنَا. Until we thought that we understood it. ثُمَّ نُقْبِلُ عَلَى الشَّرْحِ. Then we would turn towards the explanation. فَنُطَالِعُهُ, we will look at it. الْمُطَالَعَةِ, the looking. الْأُولَى امْتِحَالًا لِفَهْمِنَا. The first time, we will look at the sharah and with the objective to test our understanding. Did we understand it right or not? فَإِنْ وَجَدْنَا, if we realize. فِيمَا فَهِمْنَا غَلَطًا صَحْنَا. If we realize that we've misunderstood it, and our understanding was incorrect, we will correct it. We will correct our shortcoming of how we understood it. ثُمَّ أَقْبَلْنَا عَلَى تَفَهُمِ الشَّرْحِ عَلَى نَمَطِ مَا فَعَلْنَاهُ فِي الْمَتْنِ. Then we will do the same thing to the sharh now. The same thing that we did to the matn. We'll start opening and solving the things that are inside the sharh. If we thought that we understood the sharh, then we will go to the hashiya. Hashiya is an explanation that is put on the sharh. If it has, in كان له حاشية, if there is. Why would we do that? مراجعة, revising, امتحان لفكرنا, to test our comprehension and the way we understood it. فإن علمنا, if we come to realize, أننا فهمنا الدرس, if we come to realize that we understood the درس, تركنا الكتاب, we leave the book, واشتغلنا بتصوير مسائله, we leave the book, and we try to busy ourselves to comprehending perception of the matter in hand, in our minds. فَحَفِظْنَاهُ, we memorize it. حِفْظَ فَهْمٍ, a memorization of understanding. وَتَصَوُّرْ, and a comprehension. لَا حِفْظَ تَرَاكِيبُ أَلْفَاظٍ, not the type of memorization of the words and the letters. And then he said, ثُمَّ نَجْتَهِدُ, then we strive. عَلَى أَدَاءِ مَعَنَاهُ بِعِبَارَاتِ مِنْ عِنْدِنَا, then we strive in making sure that we fulfill or we do things with our own wordings. We use our own wordings. We reword it again. غَيْرَ مُلْتَزِمِينَ, without forcing ourselves to follow تراكيب المؤلفي, the way that the author used the wordings. ثُمَّ نَذْهَبُ إِلَى الْأُسْتَاذِ, then we go to the teacher لِلْقِرَاءَةِ, to read on him. وَهُنَالِكَ نَمْتَحِنُ, and with that, taking it to the teacher, is to test our understanding and if we understood the lesson very well. You see, he said that. نعم, وَنُقَوِّمُ مَا عَسَاهُ أَن يَكُونَ بِهِ مِنْ إِعْوِجَاجٍ, and we will strengthen and we will correct that which probably there's a bit of deficiency in. وَنُوَفِّرُ الْهِمَّةَ عَلَىٰ مَا يُرِدُهُ الْأُسْتَاذِ, and our aspiration will be so out and open to that which the teacher is going to give to us. مِمَّا هُوَ زَائِدٌ عَلَىٰ الْمَتْنِ وَشَرَحٍ, which is additional to what? The matn and the sharah don't even have it. The teacher is going to bring it from his own self, and we're ready to take that on board as well. وَكُنَّا نَرَى, we used to see, أَنَّ مَنْ قَرَأَ كِتَابًا وَاحِدًا, that anybody who read one book, min fannin in a field, ala hadhihi tariqa, in that way I mention, sahula alayhi jami'a kutub hadha al-fan, that all of the books of that field becomes easy for him. The mukhtasarat of it, the summarized books of those, and the mutawwalat, and those which are detailed, doesn't matter. وَثَبَّتَتْ قَوَاعِدُهُ فِي ذِهْنِ, and the principles stick to his mind. وَكَانَ الْأَمْرُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ, and the matter used to be like that. It used to be like that. Another advice that was given by a sheikh, his teacher. His teacher, Muhammad ibn Uthman, rahimahullah, he used to say, لَا يَنْبَغِي, pay attention to this, لِمَنْ يَقْرَأْ كِتَابًا, it is not befitting for a person who's reading a book, أَنْ يَتَصَوَّرْ, for him to have in his mind, أَنَّهُ يُرُودِ قِرَاءَةُ مَرَّ ثَانِيَ, that he's going to read this book one more time. He shouldn't have that in his mind. If you read a book, don't read it like you're going to read it again. لِأَنَّ هَذَا التَّصَوُّرْ, because that thought in that mind of yours, which is that you're going to read it again, يَمْنَعُهُ, it will prevent you from what? عَنْ فَهْمِ جَمِيعِ الْكِتَابِ, in understanding the book in its totality properly. بَلْ يَتَصَوَّرْ أَنَّهُ لَا يَعُودُ إِلَيْهِ مَرَّةً ثَانِيَةً أَبَدًا. Rather, the person should put in his mind that he's never going to go back to this book ever again. وَكَانَ يَقُولُ, he used to say, the Shaykh of Muhammad, Abdul Qadir ibn Badran al-Dimashqi, his teacher Muhammad ibn Uthman used to say, كُلُّ كِتَابٍ, every book, يَشْتَمِلُ عَلَى مَسَائِلِ مَا دُونَهُ وَزِيَادَةً, فحقق ما دونه لتوفر جدك على فهم زيادة. He used to say every book that consists of it matters besides it and more. وحقق ما دونه لتوفر جدك على فهم زيادة. Putting extra emphasis on understanding what is in it and even more additional to it. Let alone what's inside the book. وَلَمَّا أَخَذْتُ نَصِيحَتَهُ, when I took on my teacher's advice, مَأْخَذَ الْقَبُولِ, a position of acceptance, لَمْ أَحْتَجْ, I never ever required, فِي الْقِرَاءَةِ, when I ever read, عَلَى الْأَسَاتِيدَةِ, when I read on my teachers, فِي الْعُلُومِ, in a subject or a فنون, إِلَى أَكْثَرَ مِنْ سِتَّةِ سِنِينِ, 6 years. I didn't need more than 6 years. فَجَزَاهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا, may Allah تبارك وتعالى reward him with good, وَأَسْكَنَهُ فَرَادِيسَ جَنَّاتِهِ, may Allah تبارك وتعالى give him Jannat al-Firdaus. So brothers, that is basically what a student of knowledge needs to know. Inshallah ta'ala, this field, the scholars, they categorize it into three marahil. When you're studying usul al-fiqh, there are three levels of how to study it. The first book that a person should give a lot of emphasis to is, inshallah ta'ala, is number one, Risalatul Latifah by Sheikh AbdulRahman Nasir Sa'dee, which is the one that we're reading. And then the student of knowledge should then study شرح الورقات للإمام الجويني with the شرح عبد الله الفوزان الشيخ عبد الله بن صالح الفوزان with his شرح. So you رسالة لطيفة, when you take it, then you take with it شرح الورقات by الشيخ عبد الله بن صالح الفوزان with the شرح. So you take the matter and the شرح both, and then after that you do ابن حزم's book النبذ في أصول الفقه. That's the first level. The second level, the student of knowledge, he studies the book al-faqih wal-mutafaqih by al-khatib al-baghdadi, and the book al-risala by Imam al-Shafi'i, and then i'lam al-muwaqi'in al-rabbi al-alameen by Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. That's the second level. The third stage, the student of knowledge needs to go to irshad al-fuhul ila tahqiq al-haq min ilm al-usul. He should look into that, the third stage. And then he should study the book إحكام الأحكام, لا الإحكام في أصول الأحكام by Ibn Hazm, الاعتصام by Imam الشاطبي, and الموافقات by Imam الشاطبي. And once the person has studied الموافقات by Imam الشاطبي, that individual has a good grounded understanding of this field of أصول الفقه. نسأل الله تعالى أن يرفع لنا أن يرفع لهم الأجر والمثوبة. And we ask Allah تبارك وتعالى that He gives us subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he gives us the ability to understand usul al-fiqh the way it should be understood and take it from its people.